I know one thing's true when we talk or when we look across the country. It seems like the idea that tree and canopy cover equates to whitetail habitat. And it's not true in any regard, especially when we'll show out the comparisons on this video in the difference in just thick timber that has no understory versus what appears to be thin timber and a tremendous understory.
And also to keep in mind with this video, we're shooting this in July when there's the most cover available, even in that closed canopy setting that hasn't been thin. There's some underbrush, but when it comes to the fall, there's nothing there. Now there's at least some leaves. This is the best, again, scenario that you're gonna see. But in this comparison, there is no comparison to this type of cover for a whitetail versus that unthinned canopy. We're trying to put as much cover on the ground, open up the canopy, hinge some trees, some of the softwoods, elms, walnuts, the red maples, those sort of trees, flush cut other trees. So we have this variety of stump sprouts, hinges, new herbaceous growth coming in with that amount of sunlight. And essentially all that just boils down to, hey, we've got cover and we got food.
We basically brought the ceiling down. When you looked at this area just last year, you know, last May, it was closed canopy hardwoods with a lot of cedars encroached throughout it. And now basically we've opened it up. You did, not me, I didn't run the saw, but you cut it and now we've got all this new growth and this is just 1 year of growth. And you have to consider that a deer is basically from eye level 4.5 foot tall down. And in much of the country with unmanaged forests, all the vegetation is basically above their head and up.
And that's where the energy is held at, right?
Yeah.
The leaves are collecting it way above it, so there's not forage available within reach. And then the cover load is way above a deer when they're bedded down or even when they're standing. So we've got an example of a buck that's bedded down to give that, let's say, eye level perspective on a bedded deer. We need to be down here. So with this video and the comparison, we're gonna show exactly what cover looks like. And I think it's really important from a hunter standpoint of, and if we wanna increase daylight activity, we have to have good cover. One for them to be bedded in and say, hey, that's secure. I feel comfortable being there. But then two, when they get up and they start to stand, they start to move, there's forage available, or there's another term that we'll use, comfort cover, right? So this is what they're gonna seek out. And this is not just anecdotal. There's a lot of research that is supporting the fact of, you know, young forest regeneration, dense areas, that when pressure gets on during hunting season, that's where deer are going. And not just mature bucks. Like we want to probably focus in on that, but this is where just deer go, period. Yeah. And if I have that, if I can offer that, whether it is 1,000 acres, whether it is 35, it's a necessary component. If you don't have this, then you're not gonna see nearly the daylight movement, nor the consistency, because this is something that they're gonna come back to day in and day out.
And one thing to note,
choosing this preferential over a lot.
If the productive level of your farm is only at a 2 or a 3, because you've only maybe managed the timber with a fire, and you do a little bit of work and you're like, oh yeah, that really helped. There is so much more that you can provide. So you can take an area that was once a 2 or a 3 and make it a 5 or a 6, and then go in with some fire or thin the area around it, make it a 7 or an 8 on a scale of 1 to 10 and make it really productive. And even though you may be small acreage, your acreage could be an 8 while the neighbor that's got 2,000 acres only is sitting at a 4, there's a better chance that you're gonna see daylight activity on your farm because that offers the security.
Absolutely.
And the cover and also the native forage that many landscapes and many neighbors aren't providing. All right, so now we're checking in on what might be the most common forest acreage in the United States, closed canopy forest.
Closed canopy, unmanaged, just...
I think of a lot of the national forests, the big tracts of forested acres where the overall population is much lower than crop country. You don't see as many deer. There's just not as many deer there because they can't flourish.
The production
value is
so low.
Surviving.
Correct.
And so this forest is very common to see, and the site we're at is an overstory of white oak, a midstory of flowering dogwood, eastern red cedar, an understory of blackberry, coralberry, and some dogwood regeneration, but not a lot of white oak regeneration, and some sassafras I see too. So that's just not, we're losing our oak regeneration because we don't have adequate sunlight, because we're not using prescribed fire with that sunlight as much. This area has been burned, but it's not being intensely managed,
right.
Cutting out the midstory. It will in the coming years, but this is a good example of a deer laying on the forest floor in here. You can see all the way to his
white belly hair.
White belly hair. There is a need for some of this on the landscape.
Sure.
North slopes, east slopes, not all of them that are completely unmanaged, but during this time of year, like right now, it's hot. We have a breeze that's blowing through here. It's not all bad, but for
and we're going to have some mass production out of this area, but that's a small window.
Yep.
And again, we just can't confuse this type of forest cover and canopy closure as good quality cover, and that's a common misconception. But here's a great example compared to the beginning of the video of much more open canopy, lots of understory, just 1 year's worth of regeneration compared to this. We've heard it once, we've heard it 1,000 times. Cedar thickets are where the best cover's at. Well, now we've got a great comparison for you guys here in this video of a bedding thicket, a hardwood regeneration unit versus a pocket of cedars. Where's the cover?
The cover is up there. So unless you're a giraffe and you're trying to hide your head, that's about your best option. I know there's gonna be some guys that'll say, well, that's in the wintertime, cedar thickets. The only time that I would say that this is okay.
Used more. Preferred more.
Is that late winter, heavy snow, trying to get in here where it's not so deep and get out of the wind. Now, we can argue that the wind still makes it through here.
Certainly.
And it has to be arranged correctly, and you have to have good cover on the north side if it's a north wind, but that would be about the only time I would say you're gonna find deer in here on a regular basis, unless cover is greatly missing across the landscape, and this is the best cover option. But with a little chainsaw work where we're just at, you know, that's 10 yards that way, that's where you're gonna have better cover. But you, as you can see, this deer is not hidden at all.
Completely exposed.
Yeah, completely exposed. So this is just one of the general areas that people say good cover, and
right.
Hopefully this can help argue the case against that.
But also, where's the forage too? We are surrounded by deer forage, hundreds and hundreds of pounds, and there's very, very little here as well. So cover's missing, forage is very limited in this cedar monoculture.
And finally, we're at kind of in the middle of everywhere we've been so far. So we showed you a really drastic cut area that was almost borderline clear cut, that had a lot of hinge cuts mixed in, that we call a bedding thicket. Then we've gone to closed canopy forest, we've gone to cedar thicket, and now here we are in what some would call a savanna restoration or a heavy timber operation with some prescribed fire. The point being, we have a lot of herbaceous understory here that provides really good cover throughout much of the year. And so you can see this deer, or this this target, is laying, and there's plenty of vegetation with these cool season rye, the native rye, the black-eyed Susans, we've got some blackberry, we've got some native Lespedezas, various wildflowers around, we've got some stump sprouts, I see wing stem back here, a lot of vegetation from 4 foot and down. And this looks pretty burned up right now, but look pretty phenomenal and looks great a lot of years, but we are 5 weeks post rain. So it's starting to dry out, but this is really awesome cover.
And that's the important thing is this is cover right now in the growing season. And as that intermediate, we're gonna see deer activity in here throughout the growing season as this much herbaceous vegetation is available. They're gonna be browsing here, they're gonna be bedded here, but come wintertime, we lack that woody structure compared to the bedding thicket. So this is where, you know, kind of the rubber meets the road is we need all of these habitat features. We need all of these plant communities spread throughout a really good recreational property to provide benefit for every month out of the year, provide cover, provide forage for whitetails. They need to feel comfortable. But when it comes down to it, when we're in the fall, when we're hunting deer, the best cover is going to be that bedding thicket where you have that residual woody structure There is lots of stump sprouts. There's a lot of stem count coming back compared to an area like this. They're going to move very comfortably through here, and you actually have
And you will find deer that bed in this and around this.
Some pockets.
But it's not easy to pattern. It's very sporadic, and chances are a lot of our mature bucks are spending more time bedded in our thick areas than they are out on this managed timber ground.
But you will see that daylight activity through here. They're going to feel comfortable because this structure's still up. It's just not as dense during the fall and winter time frames as a bedding thicket is.
And if you're in the northern part of the country and you have heavy snows or deep snows and you have basically hard winters, a lot of this will end up laying on the ground. You'll have some brambles that poke through in the woody structure, but since this is more herbaceous, more grasses and more forbs, this is not going to withstand the winter months in the northern country. So you would need more woody structure, hinge cuts, forest regeneration to withstand it and provide cover and food in those winter months.
Hopefully this is a great way to show you guys the differences when we talk with our podcasts or other videos of quality of a structure and what really, how it changes throughout your different practices.